Hello. Good morning and welcome to this Printed Intelligence Product Development online lecture. For the next, let's say 45 minutes or so, we will focus on the topic of product development and especially what comes to the printed intelligence product development. There will be some general topics and then more specific topics for what comes to the printed intelligence. Product development in general. I think there's a lot of information that you can find from different sources about product development processes. But this is the product development process in general, in just briefly. So that's the process where your product's features and details and how you're going to implement that is being planned. There's also during that process you are making the final designs and kind of the form of the products you are designing. Product development process is usually completed in stages. So basically you have to schedule your process really, really carefully to be able to of course be on time and so that your product will be as good as possible, thinking about all the limitations you might have. During those stages, the plans become more precise. So for example, you might start with only like drawings on a paper. I think in many cases, you just have an idea and you start with it and you don't have any tools yet, but you just draw it into the paper. You have an idea. For example, on that below, the bottom left corner there, you can see that is an actual start of a planning process of one of our parts of a process. So we just started to draw it in the drawing board and well, after that you are refining that process. The plans become more precise. There are steps, of course, depending on what type of your product is, whether it's like a more electrical product or mechanical product or whatever. There are steps during that process where different kind of tools is needed. And well, yeah, after this, all these stages, you might end up with the product and sometimes you kind of fail, as you can see here in this image, but surely sometimes you have a successful product. When talking about product development and product design, there are different, how to say, schools how to think about this. So in many cases it's actually thought that product design is part of the whole product development process. They are not separate processes, but product design is actually part of this whole process. So we are now dealing with that, so that we are thinking about that design is part of that whole process. During the design process, there are certain limitations and requirements that has to be met. And thinking about printed intelligence, I think the manufacturing requirements are one of the key requirements that you have to think about quite carefully. Certainly in any process, there is the financial realities that you have to think about. And like I said already, the schedule. I think it's quite rare to have a product development process without a deadline or accurate schedule. During that design process, detailed drawings, part lists, CAD files, models, whatever of the product are done and finalized. What you should remember is that the design phase must respect kind of the laws of the technologies that you are using, and there are in many cases there are some general rules that you have to follow on the design process. For example, in the electronics design, there are rules that you have to follow so that your product will be of good quality. Design rules, standards, and stuff like that can be found for many technologies. For example, the IPC standardization organization, they are providing these standards and design rules and kind of a guidance. What should be noted is that, like in every work, you have to be systematic. And in product development process, that is really one of the key points. So you have to be systematic. You have to be able to follow your schedule and plans and stick to those. You have to be precise. And everything is, of course, focusing on the final product. And you have a definition-based activity during that process. Those solutions that you design in that product development process, they are defining up to 90% of the whole product lifecycle costs. So that kind of gives you a number of how important is to do the product development process correctly, and that's like the main work you are doing to reduce the costs, for example. What should be noted, and in every process, and also in your work, when you are doing this printed intelligence product development course development case, is that there will be plans for products or applications that at that phase, at that time, will not go forward. So you will have like kind of a plans that, for example, cannot be implemented today, but they could be done maybe within 5 years or so. You could also have plans that never go as far as production, and that is totally okay. I think you have different plans, and out of those plans you choose the best one for the requirements, and definitely what can be implemented today. When you are doing the design process, there are certain functions of the product that you are developing. This is not like a total list of everything, but those are, let's say, the one of the most important value-added functions that you are developing. So obviously the actual functionality, whether it's a technical or something else, but the functionality is being designed. So the product must be functional in a way so that it's effectively doing what it's supposed to be doing. This is highly dependent on the product that you are designing. Some of them are really complex and have really complex and multidisciplinary functionalities, to say, but anyway, that's obviously the one of the key points. Durability is something that you have to remember. The product could be used in different conditions, It could be exposed to different type of use. So it should be durable enough. I think the customer is really going to complain if your product fails within, let's say, too short time. Obviously, you would have some sort of a warranty for your product, and it's going to cost you a lot if it breaks down during the warranty time. But anyway, you shouldn't also be making, let's say, too durable product in a way, or otherwise it will cost quite a lot. What comes to the printed electronics, the manufacturability is something really important you have to think about. So first of all, like, can it be manufactured using printed electronics methods? Depending on the product, you have to think about also the mass manufacturability. So can it be mass manufactured in high volumes? It's something you have to think about. I already said about something about the costs. So you have to think about the overall costs. The manufacturing, distributing, and all the like value chain steps, they shouldn't be too expensive, so that, because you have to think about your sales price has to be covered. So you know, there are several steps you have to think about. Safety, one key element. You have to be able to verify so that your product is safe to use in normal conditions. But note, even in abnormal use, it shouldn't cause hazards to the user. So that is something you have to think about in product development processes. Obviously, if you are designing a hammer, the user can use it, let's say, in a way that it's not supposed to be used. And you might not be able to cover all the abnormal use cases. So the user might hurt him or herself with that hammer. But anyway, in many products, you have to think about that if the user is using it in an abnormal way, it shouldn't be a safety risk for him or her. About the IPR, you have to think about that. Are there any parts of the operation or the process, manufacturing process, design, appearance, whatever, so that you can be patenting that, getting a utility model or design rights or trademarks or something like that. That is something you have to think about really carefully. Patenting is a, let's say, in many cases, it could be quite a long process and it's going to be quite expensive, but you have to think about is that necessary. Design. Most of the prototypes are designed by engineer and well, they look like they have been designed by engineer, but the final product should be somehow thought about that it's kind of pleasant to look at. Of course, it serves the purpose that is needed, but design aspects has to be considered also. That has something to do with also the sales and marketing capability. So the product should be kind of designed in a way that the product sells itself. So it's like I said, pleasant to look at. It looks really convincing and stuff like that. So like I said, there are also other functions that has to be developed, but let's say there are couple of those main points that you have to think about during the process. This is from Conceptas OY's kind of a platform for what are the challenges in typical consumer product development processes and kind of what are the steps. During this course, you are focusing on those three steps that you can see there. So obviously you have to kind of do the delineation of the product and the process and refine that what are you going to do. So these are the first steps here. You are not going to go and patent your product in this course, but obviously you can think about that too. The actual ideation and product concept development is done after that, when you have refined your process and product. And there you have the concepting, the requirement specification process, and the design process, and in many cases you have also the prototyping process. During this course, like I said on the previous, like in the introductory session, so that it's not mandatory to have that working prototype in this course, but during the normal development process you will have prototypes and maybe several of them. That's called the drafting phase, where you have those. And the finishing step is where you kind of you order the tools, you order the manufacturing process, subcontractor, stuff like that, all the testing and finishing and acceptance and those are done on the finishing steps. But yeah, during this course you have to focus on these three main points and steps here. Next, we will go into the design and especially talking about printed intelligence. What are the main points you have to consider during the product development process of printed intelligence product? There are limitations of using printed electronics techniques in product development. But you have to also remember that there are benefits. Why are you using? There has to be something good about it. So that, why are you using that? You have to think about the limitations and benefits in the process. When you are talking about printed electronics and it's related to electronics, you have to think about the general rules of the electronics design. However, what comes to the printed electronics, there are actually not that many design rules or standards for printed electronics yet. The work is actually ongoing. There will be more and more standards for printed electronics and printed technologies, but currently there's not that many. But there is not that many, but anyway, there are, for example, IPC has a couple of standards, or let's say guidelines for printed electronics design. So you can see them here. So there are a couple of guidelines for designing printed electronics. For organic and flexible electronics, there's also some other guidelines. But for example, those guidelines is something that you could follow during the development process. When you are designing the printed electronics and maybe even the prototype, you have to consider the manufacturing processes of printed electronics. You have to think about the benefits and limitations of this new novel materials that you are, functional materials that you are using, and also the compatibility, for example, between the materials, compatibility of certain material to certain manufacturing technology, and so on and so on. So maybe, let's say, slightly different things you have to consider, for example, comparing to normal electronic design or mechanics design or something like that. I have a list here of some of the points on the printed electronics design process you have to think about. So maybe starting with the line width and minimum clearance. So, you know, you've been studying these manufacturing methods and there are limitations in certain manufacturing methods, what comes to the line with, and kind of how small structures can you make, what is the minimum dimensions and stuff like that. Let me just open this screen printing example. So this is from the screen printing educational material that you have the access to. So talking about the line width, there are some rules you have to follow. So for example, in the screen printing, the line width should be at least 3 times the thread diameter. This is something that maybe you just have to know. Of course, you can ask the manufacturer what is the minimum line width, but in this process, this is something that you just have to know and find the information of. Same goes with the dispensing. Let's just open that also. So this is again something you have access to on the material. So here, line width with certain nozzle of the dispensing machine. So it gives you an approximation on how narrow line width you are capable of producing with certain method. And that is something that might limit your product design process. Layer thickness is also one of the things you have to consider. Let's say again, screen printing as an example, because layer thickness has effect on let's say many things. And this is again something that you have access to. But for example, in the screen printing process, you can calculate already beforehand that what is the theoretical layer thickness after curing. And based on that, you can make an approximation. For example, in many cases, it could have an effect on the electrical functionality, the parameters. Also, like the overall thickness of your product that you are designing is dependent on the layer thicknesses, and stuff, so on. So there's a lot you have to think about. Let's say I will open the roll process information about the layer thicknesses. Again, depending on the process that it's going to be used, there are differences in the layer thickness, but also on the accuracy or the resolution. But layer thickness is really, really different depending on the method that you are using. And something you have to consider. If you are focusing on thin layers, well, obviously, there are certain methods that maybe are not that good, but you just have to choose the methods that are producing thin layers for you. Registration. The accuracy of the machines. Let me just open for dispensing, for example. That is also something that you could ask from the manufacturer. They very much possibly could give you the number of how accurate are the processes and stuff like that. But for example, the machines that we have at the print lab, you have the information on the accuracy. So you can have the access to these kind of brochures where you have the numbers for repeatability, resolution, travel range, stuff like that. I think the registration accuracy is something that you have to remember when doing multi-layer structures. Obviously, if you are doing only one layer, the registration accuracy is not that critical. But whenever you have two or more layers, the registration accuracy comes into the play. Related to manufacturing, there's also kind of a couple of parameters or design process variables that you have to think about. Yield is something. Usually the yield is quite good, but let's say in some highly functional products, the yield could be quite low. And that is something that you have to think about when you are mass manufacturing those products. Roughness is also something you have to consider. So what is the roughness of the surface that you are actually printing? And does that have any effect on the functionality of your product? So then a couple of points regarding the, let's say, the materials that you are using. So the drying time, you are familiar with this term. So on this first example, you can see that the material drying time is given here, so that it's in every case is more than 10 minutes, depending on the temperature. It could be even 30 minutes. And opening then another material, you can see that the drying time here is reduced down to 3 minutes. And it's a significant difference, 3 minutes versus the 10 minutes. That has an high effect on the manufacturing process. If you have to wait for 10 minutes for the ink to dry, it's going to slow the process really, really much. So if you can reduce the drying time to one third of that, so it's going to increase the speed of the manufacturing quite a lot. Viscosity. So opening the first material example here. The viscosity of the material here is 24,000 millipascal seconds. So now I have a question for you. Can this material be used in inkjet printing? Yes or no? And now we have another material. So we will now have the answer to the question. So the previous material, no, it cannot be used in the inkjet printing. So then you have to choose this type of material with really low viscosity. You are talking about close to 10 millipascal seconds. If you find the previous material good, but in other parameters are good, but the viscosity is high, so yeah, you cannot use inkjet printing, for example. You have to use dismissing or screen printing to print this material. But if you definitely have to use inkjet printing for the manufacturing, you have to switch to different material. Then the overall performance of the material. Let me just open again example. From the manufacturer, the ink manufacturer data sheet, you can find information on the performance of the material. Let's say, for example, here you have a couple of parameters that in many cases you have to look at. One is the resistivity of the material, and they give the number here. In this case, it's 40 milliohms per square. Please note that the resistivity could be given in many, many ways. For example, here you have the square resistance or the resistivity, and in this case they also give this volume resistivity, which is ohm per centimeter. Be careful about these numbers. So look carefully on how the resistivity, for example, is given. Something else that you might want to look at is, for example, the hardness of the of the surface after curing, how flexible it is, what are the aging properties and stuff like that. For the substrates, there's also some performance numbers that you have to look at. So this is, for example, PET substrate dataset. And what is usually interesting information is, for example, this dimensional stability. So how much the material is actually shrinking on certain temperature, for example. And the manufacturers give these numbers and graphs here for your information. Also, the compatibility is here, so something you had to think about also. Then something about the material tolerances. This is from the Tactotec presentation. By the way, these Tactotec presentations are available at the web pages. This is one of the presentations. I think this kind of summarizes the fact that, let's say, the traditional processes where you use copper as a conductive material, it's a good conductor, and the tolerance is whenever you say that it's something, it's pretty much that. Kind of the challenge with the conductive inks is that the resistance could be higher, the conductivity it's less conductive. It's not a problem in a way once you know it, but what might come as a problem is the tolerance, the variation of the conductivity. For example, it's much worse than for example with copper. But that is something that you have to deal with, and once you know it, you can deal with it. But if you have an kind of a wrong information, and then you might be in trouble. And when thinking about the electrical functionality of the product you are designing. In current product development of printed intelligence, the flexibility is quite important because, for example, on the wearable products, I think the stretchability is quite important if you are embedding that product into the clothes, for example. Just to give you an example, there's some research already done on that section. So I think, for example, Tuomas Happonen has done quite a great work on the flexibility studies of printed electronics. So this information is available. And second example is that the materials are available. So they are specifically flexible materials designed for flexible products. And I think those materials should be used to replace those, let's say, non-flexible materials in those products that where the flexibility or stretchability is needed. There's also some design things to consider. So for example, when you are designing the actual structure in a correct way, you can reduce the effects of the stretching on the product. So there's a lot of information regarding this type of design processes. Those were the things to consider on the printed electronics design process. The main points regarding the manufacturing processes and also the material and the performance.